Hello students, welcome back to my YouTube channel. I hope all of you are doing absolutely fine. So today we'll continue with this chapter, Reflection Through a Lens. Today's topic will be formation of image through a concave lens. In the last video number 4 and 5, we have discussed about the formation of image through a convex lens. Now today we will discuss the formation of image through a concave lens. Okay, concave lens. Now, the basic thing that you have to know over here is that concave lens is of what shape? Concave lens is of this shape. Okay. And another thing you have to know, what this lens can do, what is the property of this lens? It can diverge the rays. Whatever rays it will come, it will, the convex lens will try to diverge those rays. So the basic things that you have to know at the starting of the topic. Now as we begin with this, the ray diagrams, basically we have to know the three rules. The three rules first should be there in our mind. The first rule is quite easy. The first rule is similar to the convex. The first rule says what? Any ray incident towards the optical center will pass undeviated, which was also there in the case of convex lens also. So what will be the diagram of this? If we take a concave lens, and suppose this is my principal axis and this is the optical center. So as per the statement, if the ray is incident towards the optical center, can you see the ray is incident towards the optical center? What will happen? The ray will pass undeviated. You can see the ray has gone without any change in its direction. So as per the statement, incidence towards the optical center. Now you can see it is passing undeviated, which is quite simple to understand. Now, the next thing that we have to know is the other two rules. The other two rules says what? Array parallel to the principal axis, will appear to pass through the focus, will appear to pass through the focus F2. Okay, F2. Now, what does this statement means? Let's try to understand with the help of a diagram. Now, let's take a convex lens. Okay, and this is my optical center. Yes, this is the optical center. Now, also you have to know where are the focus. We have two focus, F1 and F2. So, in case of a concave lens, where is the focuses? Means, where is F1, where is F2? Suppose I take this as one focus and this as a second focus. Now, where is F1? F1 is towards the right hand side. This is my F1. And where is F2? F2 is towards the left hand side. It is just opposite to that of the convex lens. In convex lens, okay, in a convex lens, suppose this is a convex lens, here is F1 and here is F2. But you can see in a concave lens, it is just the opposite. F2 is on the left hand side, whereas F1 is on the right hand side. So you have to remember these basic differences between a concave and a convex lens. Now we come to the statement. A ray parallel to the principal axis will appear to pass through F2. So what does this line statement means? A ray parallel to the principal axis. First see like this. So a ray which is parallel, you can see this ray is parallel to the principal axis. This red line is parallel to the black line. Now, what will happen after the ray comes over here? What will happen? This, I told you, this lens has a property of what? This lens can diverge the rays, diverge. So, the rays will get diverged. So, the rays will go in this way. Okay? The rays will go in this way. The rays will diverge. Now, if we extend this emergent ray backward, if we extend the emergent ray backward, what we get to see is that the ray is passing through, say, F2. So, suppose I am just changing a little bit. So, the ray happens to pass through F2. So, you can see that this is the statement means that the ray parallel to the principal axis after refraction will diverge, and if we extend the divergent diverging ray backward, it appears to come from F2. So I hope the second statement is very well understood by all of you. Now coming to the third statement. The third statement means what? The third statement means a ray incident towards F1, a ray which is incident towards F1 will become parallel to the principal axis, will become parallel to the principal axis. Now, what does this statement means? We have to understand it with the help of a diagram. Now, if I draw a diagram, again the same thing. I draw a concave lens, and there is the principal axis. And here is F1 and here is F2, okay, near about the same distance from the optical center. Now, as I say, what, a ray incident towards F1. Now, how it will look like? Okay, there is one thing I need to do. A ray incident towards F1. So if I take a ray and it is incident towards, say, F1, means if it is trying to go towards the F1. Now what will happen over here is that it is incident towards F1. Like if I extend the ray, now it will go towards the F1, but it will not happen. Because why it will not happen? Because this ray, because this lens has a property to diverge the rays. I told you, concave lens has a property to diverge. So it will, how it will diverge? Don't think it will diverge like this. No, it is not going to happen something like this. So how the divergence will happen? Just see, I told you in the video number 2, the last 10 minutes. That is very important. How the ray is coming? Try to see, it is converging. And if a convergent ray will become parallel to the principal axis, so the ray will become something like this. The ray will become parallel to the principal axis. So this is what it will happen. A ray incident towards F1. You can see this is the ray which is incident towards F1. After refraction, obviously after refraction, will become parallel to the principal axis. Now you can see this ray is becoming parallel to the principal axis. These three rules you have to remember while doing the ray diagrams. But I'll give a first few ways to make you understand that how the diagrams will come. Now, suppose let's take a convex lens. Optical center F2 F1. Now see, I'll take two rays to draw any ray diagram. I need at least two rays. Okay, so I'll take the two rays. Suppose I take two rays, one is passing through the optical center and another is passing through F2. I need two rays, one will be passing through the optical center and second one is passing through the F2. Now what will happen? See, first I will take a ray. Which is incident towards the optical center. Now what will happen? We know that the ray which is incident towards the optical center will pass undeviated. We have learned that is the first rule. Now if we consider the second rule says what? A ray which is parallel to the principal axis will appear to pass through F2. So I think I have to draw the object. Suppose I take the object somewhere over here. Okay, this is my object. Now I am coming to the rules. A ray should be first incident towards the optical center. How it will happen? Suppose you take from the head and pass it through the optical center just like this. You can see a ray which is incident towards the optical center will pass undeviated. Now, in the second, I need a ray that should be passing through F2. How it will happen? I'll take a ray which is parallel to the principal axis. Okay? And any ray which is parallel to the principal axis, what will happen? It will diverge. So, I get what? I get these two rays. Now, how do I get the image? You just have to extend this ray backward. This ray extended backward. Extend the rays backward that is happens to pass through F2. So, extend the rays backward that it passes through F2. And at this point where both the rays coincide, that is the point where my image will be formed. Okay, that is the point where my image will be formed. So if you take at least two rays, that is of your choice. If I take first one through optical center and the second one is passing through F2, but it will pass through F2, but not in really. Okay, virtually means what? If we extend the ray backward, then it passes through F2. Means appears to pass through F2. So obviously you can understand this image is a virtual image actually, because it is formed not by actual intersection of right lines, by virtual intersections of lines. Now take the second way. I take another concave lens. F1, F2, and so near above F1. And here is the object. Now see, I need two rays. One should be passing through optical center and second one is trying to pass through F1. Now not F2. Now what will happen? See, the first ray. The first ray will pass through F1. How? Okay, I'm using a red line to draw it. A ray which is passing through the optical center just like this. Second is what? I need a ray that should be passing through F1. Do you remember third rule which I taught you? See the third rule. The third rule says what? A ray which is trying to pass through F1. So how it will happen? A ray which is trying to pass through, say, F1. Take a ray, something like this. Okay, a ray which is passing through F1. Now just see, okay, to be more understandable, okay, because these two rays are becoming quite similar to each other. Now I'll just change the diagram a little bit to make it more understandable for both, for all of you. I think I need to make my object a little bigger in height, then it will be more precise. Okay, now you will understand it much better. Take the first ray which will be passing through the optical center. Obviously, you know the ray which is passing through the optical center will pass. How? It will pass undeviated. You know the ray that will pass through the optical center will pass undeviated. Second one. Second is one. The ray should be passing through F1. Now we know a ray which is trying to pass through F1, what will happen? This ray is trying to pass through F1. But at this point, what will happen? This ray, the second ray, how it is? This is the first ray, this is the second ray. How it is? You can see very nicely it is converging. And any convergent ray will become parallel to the principal axis. Okay, any convergent ray will become parallel to the principal axis. Okay? Now, then where is the image is formed? Obviously, you have to, no real images will be formed. Because you know, you can see these two rays are diverging rays. And obviously no diverging rays are going to meet each other. Okay, so what you do, you have to extend the ray backward. This ray, extend it backward. When the rays are extended backward, now this is the point where the two rays meet virtually, and at this point is only my image is formed. So the now you can see we have to take two rays. Either we take optical center and F1, just like this, or you take optical center and F2, which I have drawn just before this. What about taking all the three rays together? Is it possible? Yes, of course it is possible. If someone asked, can we take all the three rays? Yes, it is possible, but the problem is we don't do it because unnecessarily the diagram becomes complicated. If you are getting the image by taking two rays, why go for three rays? Huh? Unnecessarily, why to make things more complicated? I am not saying that you will not get it. Of course, you are going to get it by taking three rays. But we don't require it because we need to make things more simpler. Anyways, I am going to teach you what will happen if you take three rays. Optical center, F1 and F2. I am going to draw a bigger diagram to make things more understandable. This is my convex lens. Okay, this is my convex lens. This is the principal axis. This is my optical center, and let's take two points. This is say F2, and near about the same distance, I'll make this as F1. Okay. Now after this, what I do? I have to take a object. Now obviously I'll take an object somewhere over here. This is my object. Suppose say this is my object. Okay, this is my object. Now I will try to draw the image by taking three rays. Three rays, okay? Now see, the first ray, obviously it will pass through the optical center. The first ray will pass through the optical center, something like this. The second ray, I need to pass it through F2. How it will pass through F2? By drawing a ray which is parallel to the principal axis. And third ray, what? I'll try to take a ray which is trying to pass through F1. So how will it try to? Now I have drawn the three rays. Now, what will be the output? First, this ray which is towards the optical center, how it will emerge? It will emerge undeviated. We know the rule. The ray which is incident towards the optical center will pass undeviated. Second one, this ray, the top ray, which is parallel to the principal axis. Okay, I'm talking about this ray, which is parallel to the principal axis. How it will emerge? It will emerge, it will get diverted. Okay, it will deviate. So it will deviate, and once it deviates, it will go like this. This third ray, which is at the middle one, okay, the third ray, which is trying to go towards F1, like it is trying to move towards F1. How it will emerge? It will emerge parallel to the principal axis. Okay, it is not parallel, okay, because I'm doing rough hand, you can understand. It will become parallel to the principal axis, something like this. Now these are the three rays, how it will go. Now let's see where my image will be. Suppose this ray which is going diverging, I will extend the ray backward. I will try to extend the ray backward, something like this. And this ray, which is also like going straight parallel to the principal axis, I'll try to extend the ray backward. Now you can see this is the point where all the three rays happens to coincide. Okay, this is the point where all the three rays coincide, and obviously if all the three rays coincide at this point, it is very much understood that my image will form exactly over here. That is, the image will form exactly over here. So you have to remember the three basic things. Okay, one thing is what? The ray which is incident towards the optical center will pass undeviated. Rule number one. Rule number two. A ray which is parallel to the principal axis will diverge, and it will appear that it is coming from the focus F2. Okay, it will appear that this ray which is going like this now, it appears that it's coming from F2. And the third one, a ray which is incident towards the first focus, what will happen? It will be becoming parallel to the principal axis. And this ray, you have to extend it backward. These three rules you have to know. This is the first rule, this is the second rule, and this is the third rule. These three rules, if you know, I think the rest of the ray diagram that we are going to draw will become very much easier for you to understand. So these three rules should be very much clear to all of you. Now, let's see how the ray diagrams are. Okay. The first ray diagram. The first ray diagram is what? This is my concave lens, and these are the optical center. This is the second focus, and similarly of this size, this is the first focus. Now the first rule says what? The first case says what? When the object is at infinity, when the object is at infinity. When the object is at infinity, then what will happen? The basic thing that you have to know is that when the object is at infinity, how the rays will come, how the rays will be incident, the rays will come as how? The rays will come parallel to the principal axis. If the object is at infinity, then how the rays will come? The rays are going to come parallel to the principal axis, like just like this. The rays are going to come, you can see the two rays are coming parallel to the incident principal axis. Now what will happen till after here? These two rays which are parallel to the principal axis, how they will emerge? They will diverge. These two rays are going to diverge. Okay? Okay, very good, they are going to diverge. Then where is the image is formed? Because you know these two divergent rays are not going to meet each other at any point. In fact, if they go, these two rays travel towards infinity also, these two rays are not going to meet each other. So in that scenario, what you do? You have to extend the ray backward. So you extend this ray backward. See, I am extending the ray backward. And since these are virtual rays, that's why I am drawing it a dotted line. So these rays are extending backward and these rays tries to meet each other at F2. These rays tries to meet each other at F2. So here is the point F2, where is the my image is getting formed. So what we know about this image which is formed at F2? Firstly, is it a real image? No, this is not a real image because this image is formed by virtual lines. You can see these are dotted lines. So this is not a real image. So I can say this is a virtual image. Second thing that I have to know over here. Is it erect or is it inverted? You have to know every virtual image that is formed. If all the virtual image are erect in nature, just like this, okay, this is erect and suppose say this is inverted. So this over here, this is an erect image. Thirdly, you can see the image which is getting formed, it is very small, it is like like a point size. So I can say what? It is diminished. It is very small. It is diminished. Now the fourth thing that is formed, where is the image is getting formed? The image is getting formed at the focus. Now already I mentioned previously, when we say focus, we generally mean F2, not F1. So the image is getting formed at F2. So image is formed at F2. Image is formed at F2. Now one more thing, the image which is getting formed at F2, it is on the opposite side or the same side of the object. Object is over here, suppose say. Now object and the image is formed on the same side, not like in the case of the convex lens, the image and the objects were in the opposite side, but over here it is the same side. So image is formed at F2 on the same side of object. You have to mention this whole thing. The image is formed at F2 on the same side of the object. So I hope you understood the case 1. Case 1 is quite easy to understand. Now, second thing that we do is, when the object is at far distance, when the object is at far distance, then how the image will be formed. Let's try to understand it by drawing a ray diagram. So, now firstly, before I begin, I need to make you one thing very clear. What do you mean by far distance? Far distance means that the object distance, that my object distance is very much greater, is greater than the focal length. Okay? This is the meaning of far distance, my object distance, which is you. It is greater than the focal length. So my object distance, suppose say the focal length is 5 cm and my object distance is near about say 100 cm. So I can say my object distance, which is represented by the letter U, is greater than the focal length, which is represented by the letter F. You can take an example. My object distance is 100 cm and my focal length is only 5 cm. I hope this part is understand, all of you understood. I'm rubbing it because I need some space. Now, how to draw the ray diagram over here? See, it is very easy. You have to take a ray which is parallel to, which is incident towards the optical center. So, you take a ray which is incident towards the optical center. So, first ray will be incident towards the optical center. What about the second ray? What do you do? You take a ray, second ray, which is incident towards the first focus. Suppose you take the ray which is incident towards the first focus. I'm taking an idea because I don't have a scale. So, yeah. So, you can take two rays. First ray is incident towards the optical center and the second ray is incident towards the first focus. Now, what will the output of the rays? This ray which is incident towards the optical center will pass undeviated. Okay, it looks like a deviated, but it's actually undeviated, okay? It's undeviated. And the second ray, which is incident towards the first focus, what will happen? Remember the third rule? The third rule says what? If the ray is incident towards the first focus, the ray will emerge parallel to the principal axis. The ray will emerge parallel to the principal axis. So this is how this ray will go. Now, obviously, this is very much understood that these two rays will never meet each other because you can see these are two divergent rays. So, as a result, you have to make the, you have to draw the image, you have to extend the rays backward. So, if I extend the ray backward, something like this is formed. Now, I have to do a little bit of adjustment because I am not doing with the help of any scale. So what you do, where is my image is formed? Image is formed where these two rays coincide. So at this point, that is the image is getting formed. And if you form the image, it is like this. So this is the image which is getting formed. Now, so what we know about this image? The first thing that we know about this image is what? This is a virtual image because you can see this is a dotted ray. So this is not a real ray. So this image is not formed by the actual intersection of lines. So I can say it is a virtual image. Secondly, all virtual images are erect. Like I told you, this is erect. So it is erect. Third thing that we know from here. What we know about the third rule? That this size is very diminished. Although it is looking very big, but if you consider the object which is at a far distance, the object may be size of a tree, and the size of a tree is coming to, suppose say this size, so this marker size, what can be the size of this marker? 10 cm. So a tree which is near about say 20 foot 30 foot is coming to 10 cm. So I can say what? It is highly diminished. It is highly diminished. And ultimately the fourth point, where is the image is getting formed? Image is getting formed at F2 on the same side of the object. So formed at F2, image is formed at F2, same side of object. Okay, so you have to remember this four characteristics regarding the object at far distance. I hope you understood this point. Now this is case number three. This is case number two. Now case number three is what? When the object is beyond 2F2. When the object is beyond 2F2, I'll do that. When the object is beyond 2F2, then where is the image is getting formed? So let's try to understand it by a ray diagram. Again the same thing, I have to draw the concave lens. Okay, this is my principal axis, this is my optical center. Suppose this is my F2 and this is my, say, similar distance F1. Now over there you have to go one more step further, you have to take the center of curvature also. So say center of curvature will be something over here, and I told you, we don't represent the center of curvature by C, we represent it by what? Double of this distance. So double of F2, so it is twice F2, and this is what? Say this F1, this becomes what? Twice of F1. Okay. Now, what we do over here, the object is beyond 2F2. So, where is my object? My object is like this. Object is beyond 2F2. Now, where, how the image will be formed? I think we have to repeat the same thing. The same thing. What? The ray will come towards the optical center. The ray will be coming towards the optical center. Similarly, like. And the second ray is what? The second ray will become parallel to the principal axis. The second ray will become parallel to the principal axis. So you understood these two rays? Now, how the output of the rays will be? This ray will become, this ray will just become undeviated, and this ray will be, how it will emerge? It will become divergent. So this is how the two rays will emerge out. Now where is the image is getting formed? For that we have to extend the ray backward. So if I extend this ray backward, okay, extend this ray backward like this. Now this is the point, where is the image is getting formed. So this is the point where my image is getting formed. So this is my image, okay. So image is getting formed actually where? Beyond, between the optical center and the focus F2. So what are the characteristics? The same thing over here, the characteristics are repeated the same thing. It is virtual because it is formed by virtual rays. Second thing will be what? Erect. You can see it is erect. Third thing is what? You can see it is small size, this is big size. So I can say what? Diminished. And where is the image is getting formed? Image formed between focus F2 and optical center on the same side of the object. On the same side of object. These are the four characteristics of it. Now, where is this? I think this is understood, okay, because we are repeating the same ray diagrams. One passing through the optical center and second one is becoming parallel to the principal axis and it's getting diverged. And we are extending the ray backward. Now, where is this concave lens of this case 3? This is actually case number 3. Where it is used? It is used in spectacles for short-sighted persons, okay, or myopic eyes. So, it is used in spectacles, not for everyone, okay, who have a myopic or say short-sightedness. Okay, what is myopic short-sightedness? I think you in biology these terms are there. So these spectacles are there. This lens is used in the spectacles which has a short-sighted problem. So I think this part you understood very well. Now there is no case 4 as per the book is concerned, but in the theory there is written one case 4 which I will do it by a diagram. It is not there in your book, but it is very much important for you to understand the case 4. Now case 4 says what? Case 4 says when the object is at F2 focus. Okay, when the object is at the focus F2, then where is the image is getting formed? Try to understand it by the help of a ray diagram. Now, as per the rules book, the heading says, my object is at F2. So, suppose you consider this as your object and this is at F2. Now, where is the image is getting formed? Try to understand it. The same thing. The first ray has to pass through the optical center as undeviated. Okay, the first ray passes through optical center as undeviated. And the second ray will become parallel to the principal axis. Okay, parallel to the principal axis. And it will divert. Now it looks like this. So you know these two rays are not going to meet each other. So what you do, you extend this ray backward. If you extend the ray backward, now at this point, the two rays coincide, and this is the point where my image is getting formed, okay, because you know this ray which will be diverging, this will not meet, so you extend the ray backward and it appears to pass through F2, the second rule. And at this point where the two rays coincide virtually, this is the point where my image is getting formed. Now the same thing, it will be virtual, the characteristics are same. This is virtual, this is erect, small in size. But what I want to be more specific about, what is the position of this object? What is the position, sorry, of the image, position of image? To be exactly precise, this image position is the halfway distance between the optical center and the second focus. This image is at a halfway distance. Means what? If this is say from here to here is 2 cm, then from here to here also 2 cm. So this image is at a halfway distance between optical center and F2. Optical center and F2 के एकदम सेंटर में, बीच में, So this is the thing that you have to know over here. Now, what are the few things that you understood by these four diagrams, that for all the cases that I have drawn, what are things that you understood, the inference that you have to discuss over here? I hope you understood. The one thing I just want to say from here, if you have noticed the pattern, in the case one, when the object was at infinity, where the image is getting formed, the image was getting formed at f2. When the object was at far distance, that time also the image was getting formed at f2. Now, when the object came closer, like beyond 2f2, the image was not at f2, but the image was between optical center and the second focus, somewhere over here. Okay, at this point, somewhere over here. Now, as I bring my object closer, that is at exactly at f2, then where is the image is getting formed? Image is getting formed exactly in the between the optical center and focus. Now, what do you understood? Previously, it was here. Now, in the second scenario, it became over here. The third scenario is become over here. That means what? As the object is coming closer towards the lens, the image is moving towards the optical center, or I can say as the object is coming closer and closer, the image is shifting from the focus towards the optical center. So the first thing that we have to know, the inference over here, is what we have to know. As the object, moves closer to the lens, the image moves, or the image moves from the focus f2 towards optical center O. So when the object moves closer towards the lens, the image also moves closer towards the optical center. This is the first thing that you have to know. Second thing, if you have noticed all the diagrams, one thing was common in all the diagrams. The image was smaller in size compared to the object. The object was bigger in size and the image was smaller in size. The second thing that we have to know over here is what? The image which is formed, is smaller in size compared to the size of object. Okay, the object is bigger in size and the image is smaller in size. And third thing also, you have seen all the images which are formed, they were all virtual images. And as a result, they were all erect in size. So they were all virtual and erect. So these are the three points that you have to, that is the idea that you get from the concave lens. So in a concave lens, these are the three inference. I hope these are the things that we have to learn about the concave lens part. After this, just you see the difference. Okay, after C, just see the difference between the concave lens image and a concave lens and a convex lens. So after this, that you have to go through the concave, convex and a concave lens difference. Just there are 3-4 points. You have to understand those 3 points, which are based on the diagrams only. Like what? In a concave, you get always a virtual image, but in a concave, you get a real as well as a virtual image. Real images is formed everywhere except between the optical center and focus, where you get the virtual. So you should write like this. Over there you can say what virtual images are always erect. This is erect. This is mostly inverted. But in one case you get that as a erect when the object is between the optical center and the focus, F1. So you have to remember the differences between the concave and convex. Other than that, everything in the second part has been covered, which can come for the exam. After this, you understood the concepts or the logics. you should try doing the back question answers, which are the basically the ray diagrams which are there in the 5B exercise. You practice those diagrams, and obviously by doing that, the logics or the, you will understand this chapter in a much better way. So I hope you, this is all for lecture number 6. If you have any doubts, please write in the comment section, and don't forget to hit the like button for this video. If you understood it, very good. If you haven't understood it, please watch the video once more. So till then, bye bye, take care, good night.